joy to be here with all of you today, to bring you all together to pay tribute to the mother of every horror host who ever lived or died, the great Vampira.
Yeah! Oh, Vampira. You know, she was the godmother. Held us all close to her breast. Place I like to be. No.
Vampira was the matriarch to all of us that came after her, all of the mutant offspring that she begat.
She was the foremother, if you will.
If you will.
If you will, of horror hosting. Vampira brought sexy and sultry and a little bit of sassy to the horror genre. And in doing that, I think she made horror movies and horror hosting more accessible to the average American.
There have been television hosts out there. They've been around for a while. But bringing it to a grown-up audience, to an adult audience, and for the time, she was so over-the-top sexy.
Well, she was a great lover. Well, that's private. Can you nix that part? Anyway.
She was such a striking figure. You know, she just had this look to her, and she just gave off an aura of just cool. She was this cool woman. And I was always fascinated by just her appearance alone.
Ricky and Lucy were still sleeping in separate beds, okay? But Vampira was spilling the girls. And she knew how to work it. And she brought you into her world, you know? And she was sexy, and she was frightening. She was really the first to bring those two together. You know?
People would be more likely to watch horror having this sexy vixen hosting it. She made the vamp and being ghoulish kind of a little bit more mainstream, or at least acceptable, so that when I was a little blue chick running around cemeteries, my mother didn't freak out.
She kept it spooky. Even though she was fun, she kept it spooky. That was something that Vampira taught us, was that this sexy seductress vampire lady who's lived for hundreds of years in the middle of the night sucking on the blood of the villagers, you know, that she has a sense of humor.
Vampire used to love to have cocktail recipes on her TV show, and she used to like to recite poetry, and here was one of her favorites. Here's to zombies, the living dead. May you find one beneath your bed. They drink blood. You should too. Hemoglobin is the drink for you. Trickle, 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 trickle. Let's all have a drink to zombies.
There's very little existing footage of her show, but what does exist has a sort of a surreal, magical quality to it. It's very eerie, and she has the morbid humor.
I liked her presentation. You know, she played it straight. She came right out there. She would be funny, but not like in a hokey jokey, let's throw a rubber chicken around type way. You know, she was the real deal.
She kind of symbolized a lot of things that all other horror hosts came to symbolize in some form or another. Things like kind of a dark mystique, but being humorous at the same time, you know, seeming accessible, but seeming foreboding. You know, you'd be kind of frightened to see Vampire late at night, but then you would also, she had an allure, of course, and she also had an invitingness and a humor that made you want to watch, even if you were kind of frightened, like a lot of, you know, television audiences would have been in 1954.
She was a personality more so than a horror host. You know, she was known for, you know, Planet for Outer Space. She was known for being Vampira. I didn't really know much of her hosting until a few years back when I was able to get the existing footage of her hosting, and I was just amazed by the way she was. It was very different from the perception of her as being very stiff and quiet, mostly from Plan 9.
Plan 9 was the first time we saw a Vampira.
Oh, yep. Gotta be.
Definitely.
Well, that poster was like, you know, that was like the Farrah Fawcett poster of horror posters.
Of horror, definitely.
You know, yeah, I had a beach towel version of that poster.
Oh, you did not.
Yeah, I did.
I was about 5 or 6 years old at the time, and in seeing Plan 9 from Outer Space at that age, it was really my first introduction to the surreal. The idea of looking out the window of a spaceship to a pair of zombies in a graveyard was just so disconcerting that really kind of created a shock of surreal inspiration in my head. The image of Vampira in the film usually accompanied by this strange mechanical trilling sound just created this discordant combination of image and sound that, for me at least, personally, defined the sheer strangeness of Vampira.
My first contact with Vampira was primarily through photographs. I'd seen pictures of her in monster magazines and just magazines about spooky stuff.
Magazines. 60s and the 70s, it was paper magazines, and we didn't know her from, I didn't know she was a TV host. I might have read that, but I saw her on the thing going, Jah.
We all grew up knowing Vampira, whether we knew what she really did. I didn't know she was a horror host. She was just a lady I saw on Famous Monsters for years. She was right there with Bela Lugosi and everybody like that.
So she is so far beyond the footage that she shot. She's so far beyond being a host. She created a mythology.
And Maila Nurmi herself is a great heroine to me because she just has this. She was a really intelligent, outspoken woman who was very firm in her convictions and in her beliefs, and she just had this real artistic perception of the world. I love listening to her interviews. I never tire of listening to hearing her talk about her experiences and her feelings about the world, seeing the world through her eyes.
Maila Nurmi single-handedly created a template for the TV horror movie host that in one form or another has been the prevailing image.
To this day, that formula of creating a style that goes with horror movies, and usually involving comedy, and usually involving outlandish, caricaturish performances of some sort, that style exists to the present.
In a lot of aspects of it, she's never been topped. There's never been anyone who really had the dark sexuality more so than she did.
As you can see looking at me, I kind of modeled myself after her statuesque figure. You can see that I have very small waist.
You know, it's important to have an icon. It's important to have Vampira there. It's important to recognize where we all come from, sort of the base, sexy, curvy base of our family tree, you know. And I think that she will stand as an inspiration to future generations of horror hosts for years to come.
She hung out with such diverse Hollywood icons as James Dean and Ed Wood. Yet she herself has become an icon as enduring as both of them. Isn't that true?
Yes, yes, it is.
It's a shame that she's not here today at this event. It's really a shame. But I'm glad that so many people care about her now, and she's a great lady. I mean, she began the whole thing.
Thanks for being the first. Yeah. You know, you made us what we are today.
If it weren't for you, we wouldn't be here.
No, that's true.
Seriously.
And if you are here right now, please knock 3 times.
It was after Vampira's short but explosive success that the shock package was released. Universal put all of their classics together in a package.
There were 52 movies, one for every week of the year, and a local TV station could buy those movies at a really bargain price. And those movies were bought by every station in the country. Every station in the country then got a horror host. The original model for that was John Zacherle in New Jersey and New York.
Zacherle is the king. I mean, he really is the one who nationally set the bar.
Let
Let's sit here and watch it together. My wife is here, and we'll be bringing her into the scene pretty soon. But first, I... Yes, my dear. Joe, I better go say hello. Just a minute. I'll say just a little word. Just stay here, Joe. Yes, my dear. Yeah. Yes. 3D, my dear. 3D. She wants a little action. You know. Wait a minute. Let's go, Rick. Take a deep breath. Take it. All right. I hold still. That a girl. Oh, she rolled up. Oh, wait a minute, my dear. Hey, oh, better. Feels good, huh?
This laughter he had, and Musty smelling his own armpits and things, and he'd throw the films around.
When they released the shock packages of the horror movies, you know, that the TV stations were creating programming of all different kinds, whether it was cartoon shows and wrestling and roller derby, and then they had the horror host, you know? And every city had one to introduce the movie and cut up on it and make you want to watch this bad film.
Other horror hosts started popping up all over the place, and it was really great as I was traveling around to be able to find a different horror host in almost any town.
Shakotomie Theater with Asmodeus, and I believe he was showing The Beast with a Million Eyes that night. And it was a revelation. I had seen horror, I had seen sci-fi, but this was the first time that I had seen a grown-up dressed for Halloween introducing these films. It was a totally new concept.
Back in the Detroit area, we had Sir Graves Ghastly on in the afternoon. We had the Creature Feature on in the afternoon. I'm talking Saturdays, by the way. And then Saturday nights, we had a cat called the Ghoul, and he was on at midnight on Channel 20. And, you know, for me, it was like an entire day of great classic monster movies, you know, and it was so perfect.
In Nashville, Tennessee, they had Savad. Savad was hilarious because his fake fangs kept falling out of his mouth while he kept talking. But he just kept talking. These fangs were just flopping around inside of his mouth all over the place. But he still kept talking in that Tennessee robe.
1973. That was the very first episode of Creature Feature in Washington, D.C. with Count Gore Duvall. He's here today. He's like my best friend. I watched it as a kid. He was also Captain 20 and Bozo the Clown. Every kid in Washington, D.C., there was no cable, there was no VCRs, there was no satellite, there was TV. And Channel 20 had every kid in the Washington area. Probably a million kids he had viewing him.
You know, when I came along, I was second generation. This is when the UHF station started putting horror hosts on the air. Some of us did it live. I did live for a little while, and then we did tape.
Channel 4 here in Indianapolis asked me if I would be their horror host. Sammy Terry was in hiatus at that moment, and so I took the job quite willingly. Unfortunately, I hadn't planned on being across from Saturday Night Live when Belushi and Aykroyd and Radner and all the others were aboard. So I remember them saying, this week we have the Rolling Stones. Next week's special guests are going to be Paul Simon and George Harrison. Now, that may not mean a lot to you younger generation, but believe me, back in my day, I watched. anyway, but that's how I became a horror host.
Well, it was either that or selling insurance, you know. I backed into it by accident, actually.
Yeah.
I was drinking beer with the general manager one night, and I said, you know what we need? We need the horror host. And he said, you're hired. It was that simple. So I went from being the 10 o'clock news anchor, and 10:20 I threw it to the sportscaster on Saturday nights, and at 10:30 I had to be in makeup, in my coffin, and ready to host horror movies.
Oh my goodness.
And that's how it all started. It's been downhill ever since.
We want to go back to the 80s. I'd say yeah. Up All Night with Rhonda was...
And Gilbert Godfrey!
Oh my gosh, remember Gilbert?
Oh yeah.
And Joe Bob?
I remember reading him over 20 years, when he first started publishing, and thinking, this guy writes the way I think. This is exactly how I think in my head. Yeah. So Joe Bob has been a huge influence.
I would wake up early in the morning on Saturdays at around 11:30, 12, and turn on Commander USA's Groovy Movies! And I would love it.
I always referred to him as the Cliff Clavin of horror hosts because he had sort of this genial, hey, you know, kind of thing. And I loved him. I used to watch him all the time.
Elvira, because she was on where we lived.
Elvira, needless to say. I'm trying to remember exactly what it is about her. I think it's a couple of big points, but I can't really put my finger on it. You know what I mean?
Well, and Tad here's a Bay Area kid, so he had
Bob Wilkins. John Stanley.
Yeah, you were pretty lucky.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Captain Cosmic.
Woo!
Bob Wilkins showed up on KTVU Channel 2 with Creature Features, and from that point on, I was just completely hooked on this as a genre.
Shock Theater in Chicago on WBKB with Marvin, who was a beatnik. He had these big Coke bottle glasses, and he had a wife who was a blonde, and we never saw her face, and that's where I saw my first run through of the classics of Dracula, Frankenstein, Bride of Frankenstein, great godson of Dracula, twice removed on his mother's side.
In Indianapolis, our first horror host was Selwyn. You know, he was on for a couple of seasons, and then we launched into Sammy Terry.
We're big fans of Count Scary.
Dr. Paul Bearer.
Houlihan and Big Chuck, the Ghoul Super Host.
Shock Theater in Dayton, Ohio.
Ghoul a Go Go.
I mentioned Sinister Seymour a little bit earlier.
The Cool Ghoul from Cincinnati.
I don't remember who it was, but it was on TV and it scared the crap out of me.
We like horror movies, and we like people introducing horror movies to us. And that's what we like. That's what we do.
Horror hosts went so far beyond just hosting horror movies. They became a face to their community, to their region. And the beauty of having regional horror hosts is people can say, my horror host. There's an ownership that people feel in their horror hosts. And it's something that they hold very personal, you know. I'd say more than their local football team or their local baseball team or whatever. You know, their horror host is something that they hold very true and very dear to their hearts. In fact, Savad was so huge that when the Nashville, Tennessee Chamber of Commerce, yeah, I don't remember the year, but they put together this expansive video about Nashville, who we are. And it was sent out to industry and commercial activities across the nation, probably throughout the world, introducing them to Nashville, Tennessee. Come to Nashville. Guess who the host of this video, the person who was the face of this video to represent Nashville to the world, was Savad.
Good evening. I am Savad, your monster of ceremonies for fantastic features. Please try to pay attention while we present for your enjoyment and edification another lively one from our monumental morgue of monstrous motion pictures.
So, you know, in the 60s, it really started to kind of gain some momentum. In the 70s, it got huge. In the 80s, it exploded and died.
Essentially, the horror host doesn't exist anymore. Not in the classic sense.
Cable television came along, and local access channels started losing some of their viewership.
They sort of started to eliminate the host, or at least the... Well, they moved on to Rhonda Shear and Gilbert Godfrey. Rhonda Shear had some boobies, and Gilbert Godfrey was funny and whiny.
It did hold on. It held on by a very thin strand, you know, through the 90s.
And this is a genre that at its height probably supported about 500 hosts across the country at a given time, at its peak in the late 50s and mid 60s, say. It's just not there anymore.
It was a great career. We had spent 50, I ended up moving from Paducah, Kentucky to the nation's capital in one fell swoop. It's a convention, you know.
Yeah.
And then in 98 became the first horror host of the internet at www.countgordon.com.
The internet making entertainment not only accessible to anybody, but the ability to produce entertainment and put it out there. It's ridiculously simple now.
You have one of the old horror hosts, one of the classic horror hosts, Count Gore Duvall, who saw the coming of this internet technology that allows for people to produce programs on TV. He acts as sort of a bridge between the old technologies of local television and this modern technology of the internet. And he acts as something of an elder statesman on his weekly webcast program. So he's also a singular personality in this whole changing landscape of hosting.
The technology has changed. The way that things happen hasn't. What has happened and changed tremendously is the fact that we know about each other and we can share experiences and get a handle on what works and does work, what people like and they don't like, things like this. And we can share things, which you couldn't do. When I was in Washington, for all those years, I didn't know any of the other horror hosts around the country.
I never really had my own horror host. A few years back, I found Ghoulagogo on Public Access and started doing research on them and found that there's tons of them and they're still doing it. And I started my website to help other people find them easily because they're not easy to find.
It's exciting and very interesting to see people creating new works on their own for these new markets, whether it's internet or self-produced DVDs, etc. And you can absolutely see the form from which they've evolved.
One day you like monster movies, the next you're dressed up like this. And your parents just think, I sent him to college, I don't understand.
Yeah, I'll tell you, I was sending in a picture to Sir Graves Gastly when I was a kid. Actually, I sent him a lot of pictures. I even tell you, when some kids were trying to find out where Santa Claus was or the Easter Bunny, that sort of thing, I was going through the Macomb Daily trying to find out where Sir Graves might be next. And I would send him pictures, and one day he put a picture that I drew on as best I could at, I don't know, 11, 12-ish, whatever, of a Wolfman. And he put it on TV one time, and man, I just went ballistic. I just thought that was the coolest thing in the world. And I think that it was then that I wanted to, you know, do something like this.
What we would do, I this cousin of mine, she's not quite put together right. And we would actually dress up as the people from the Shock Theater, or Nightmare Theater, and she wouldn't let me be Dr. Cadaverino, of course, because she was older and bigger and pushed me around. And I'll never quite forgive her for that.
Oh, I was introduced to them as a baby, literally. My mother used to watch horror movies, and I used to watch them as a small child sitting on her lap. I grew up with them.
I think you have to be a little bit creative and a little bit crazy to be a horror host. It has to be something that you love because, you know, how else can you go to your mother and say, hey, every weekend I put on a mask and I make fun of movies that are kind of bad and I don't get paid for it. It has to be something that you love and you have to be a fan of it.
Not one of you goes to work. Not one of you writes your shows. Not one of you films your shows and bicycles your shows around the country. Not one of you does it for money. You all do it because you love what we love and what Vampira grew to love. The wonderful monster movies that have thrilled and entertained us over so many, many years.
I grew up next to a drive-in and my brothers would sneak in the back and it was still there when I was a teenager and went on dates and stuff like that. So for me, it's a little bit of a nostalgia trip down memory lane. Back in the old tin speakers on the window day, we could go out into our yard and just carefully listen and we could tell what was playing just by the music, or we could actually occasionally hear snippets of dialogue coming through the trees. Wafting like a sweet scent. Yes, that's it. Sweet scent of evening primrose. Yeah, but it's also mainly for the humor. I just love watching these flicks and just having a good time.
Sometimes I like to host seriously, where we're just talking about the serious aspects of the movie, the artist. Sometimes the movie is irrelevant, and we're doing interviews with famous people, and they just happen to be near the dungeon at the time. Sometimes movies, you get bad movies that are so bad, you get a real lot of fun.
hacking them up.
They're just funny, mm-hmm. You know? And some of them, kind of with a nod and a wink, know they're funny, and some of them have no idea, and they're even more funny. You know, they don't have any idea that they're supposed to be funny.
When people talk about horror hosts, it's always some balance between humor and horror. Horror hosts tend to inject some type of humor, whether it's subtle, whimsical, or extreme and goofy, into the hosting of the films.
I know, think about it. After you're scared, what's the first thing you do?
You laugh.
Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
They're both true feelings.
To me, a horror host is an intermingling of those elements. I mean, you have both. And I guess it started out with sort of a spooky template, and then I started gradually plugging humor into it. The early episodes, it was sort of a little more spooky, but then you start working in the wisecracks and the little asides and that sort of thing. And Penny Dreadful is sort of an intermingling of those elements. I like to play up some of the episodes, the spookier side of things, and then some of the episodes are a little more slapstick, or it's sort of like a Charles Adams sort of a thing, or an Edward Gorey sort of a thing, where it's a macabre humor, it's gallows humor,
yeah.
It's morbid puns and that sort of thing.
And you know, horror movies are kind of for someone who isn't like, you know, entirely versed in horror movies, someone who didn't grow up with them maybe, or even for like small children, you know, a lot of horror hosts are family friendly. It helps to have this sort of liaison who can make the horror movies easier to swallow.
We're sort of the keepers of the flame, and because, you know, we're accessible in our 9-to-5 bodies, people have seen us on their local stations or on their cables or on the internet and say, wow, I like what they do. And occasionally we get to show or discuss the more famous monsters of any generation.
You know, it's fun going out and taking these old movies and turning a whole new generation of kids on to really bad movies. Or as Mr. Lobo would say, just misunderstood.
The quintessential movie that we love to host is
Planet Nine
from Outer Space.
Absolutely.
Word.
With Vampira. And Ed Wood, everybody loves Ed Wood.
Grave of the Vampire, I had just seen for the first time, yeah. And I was like, this is good.
I know. Well, it's got that 70s schlock appeal, you know, that you just love that kind of stuff.
All right, here we go. Okay. I hate this film. But it's fun to host, mm-hmm. The Beast of Yucca Flats. It is one, you know, as far as I'm concerned, by far and away, it is the worst horror movie ever made. I mean, anything Ed Wood ever did looks like Citizen Kane next to this film. But everyone knows it's so bad that I don't feel guilty about telling people what a piece of crap this is.
And the premise for that one is we force somebody to watch, this fan that writes us a mean letter, and we force him to watch The Beast of Yucca Flats. That's his punishment for sending us a mean letter. So it's like, and it is punishment watching that.
What the different hostings of these movies do is it actually shows us that there are different ways people see movies. Their interpretation of what they just saw was different than yours, and you actually have a chance to see what they were thinking.
There's so many different tastes of the genre. It's like, you know, you got peanut butter and jelly over here, you got some salmon over here, some pizza over here. It's all food, but there's all sorts of different kinds. It's kind of like Marvel Comics, you know? It's like, well, show us your superhero, to Stan Lee. And he opens up the briefcase and blammo, it's Captain America, Batman, Superman, and Spider-Man, and the Green Hornet, and the Yellow Green Hornet, and everybody. It's like superheroes, kind of. And that's the movie we're going to start making this summer. I'm going to pay everybody $50 and a case of beer.
You know, it's just been this whole compendium and spectrum of different beings. And so everybody's got one that sort of resonates with them, and they say, I'm all about that. So if he's there, I'm going.
And there's so many different styles. It really puts a personal spin on it, and there's dialects, you know, like when you go to New England, everybody talks like, hey, I'm going to pack the car to Boston. You know, you go to Chicago, they go, Chicago. You go to Kentucky, you're like, hey! You go to Florida, and like, hey, you know, or wherever, there's dialects and stuff. So where you get regional stuff. You have all kinds of like regional geographic things placed in with these shows.
I think that's what's great about the Horror Host thing. It speaks to a lot of people in that way, and there's so many different ones. I mean, I've seen, there's grandparents that are having family night with their kids and watching my show in Kenosha, Milwaukee. You know, it's become something that it's non-general, there's no generation gap in the Crimson Theater, you know?
I can see other people's work across the world nonstop, and there's more and more, and there wasn't 5 years ago.
The Horror Host was this smoldering ember, kind of closed up in a box, and we lifted the lid, and some oxygen rushed in. This thing is just really starting to burn again. In fact, beyond the borders of our country, you know, Nigel Honeybone, his show was nominated for the Australian version of an Emmy.
Nigel Honeybone, Nigel, are you there? Nigel, come in. Come in, Nigel. We're here.
Hello, good evening, and welcome, fellow horror hosts and guests. Have you seen my face? I can't seem to find it anywhere. Anyway, I'm Nigel Honeybone, and I host the Schlocky Horror Picture Show screened throughout Australia and New Zealand. When they asked me a couple of minutes ago to say something nice about my old friend Vampira, I was delighted to charge them my usual fee. They declined, so now I'm going to say what I bloody well want. Always told me to keep up a facade of being rude and tight-fisted, just to keep people on their toes and off mine. Really, I'm quite kind and gentle and occasionally generous with my time, but I do feel great talent, like what I've got, should not go unrewarded. But we were talking about the hourglass with eyes. I first met Vampira on a train on the way to Los Angeles. She was eating her ticket at the time. I discovered afterwards she was nibbling out the date before the ticket collector came along. I said to her, why don't we start a double act together? Do you know a little joke? And she said, yes, you. So I guess she did. I handled the money. We split everything straight down the middle, 60-40. I got the 60, of course, because as her sofa, I had more screen time. Not that it was that bad a job. And that's how it all started. She's insulted me ever since. 2 days later, when I was entrusted with hosting the Schlocky Horror Picture Show, I was delighted to have the opportunity to emulate Vampira, having studied under her and behind her, and from a few other angles. She set the high standard to which we all aspire, but so few reach. I know I'm one of those few. Mother told me so. Horror hosts go, and as horror hosts go, Vampira will always be the one remembered forever. Valet Vampira, without you, the world is a little less creepy. Toodles!
And that kind of brings us to HorrorHound Weekend 2010, Indianapolis, Indiana.
HorrorHound Weekend, the Dark Carnival Vampira tribute, was incredible. It brought hundreds of hosts, or almost 100 horror hosts.
Still the most ever.
The most ever altogether.
This is an amazing, once-in-a-lifetime experience, for sure. I mean, I think this is the first time in history we've ever had this many horror hosts in one place. This place is just bursting at the seams with ham and spookiness.
The entire Horror Hound convention, and especially Jason Hignite and his mad idea to bring all these horror hosts together, has been a wonderful, wonderful thing.
I wanted to do it Dark Carnival, and didn't work out, but it was fortuitous that it happened that way. Because, you know, the very next March, Horror Hound Weekend, they opened their arms, their rotting, necrotic arms to us. And, you know, we brought an event together that, you know, originally we were hoping for, if we can get 24 hosts to show up, that'd be great. We had almost 70 horror hosts show up for the first event. And blew our minds that this many people were this excited about something.
And instead of, you know, it being a competitive sort of landscape, it was completely...
Red Dawn Brotherhood.
It was amazing. I mean, the energy, the excitement.
The old school hosts, they didn't really know of each other back in the day. And the ones that did, it's like they didn't want their fan base to know about the other ones. We, on the other hand, we want to bring the awareness to everyone so that everyone knows what's going on. And that's one of the things I liked about Horror Hound Weekend and had to be here, is because there was, you know, the largest gathering
thus far of horror hosts, and you know, new and established and everyone else, you know.
Oh, man, all these new guys are blowing my mind. These young guys with lung capacity and stuff hanging from the chandeliers. I'm trying to do that, but I'm old. You know, I stand, do the fall down and add the clunky sound effects of my bones rattling. There's not really sound effects being added either. It's a microphone in my rib cage. But the hosts are all just so great, man.
It was just like a door opener for all of us horror hosts to come together and really meet one another and start, you know, interacting, which I think really brought forth like a new era of horror hosting.
Most of these guys, it's all like a big extended family. These are my brothers and my sisters, and you know, or you know, and then I met some people here this weekend. You know, I met a couple of cutie. I met Ivana Cadaver. She's a cutie.
Carlos Borloff behind us, and Count Gordival was on the other side, and that was just such a thrill. That was just amazing.
Time of my life.
We probably are going to look like a bunch of little giddy girls down there. But yeah, just fantastic. Yeah.
There's a lot of people that I knew before, you know, some good friends, and I've got to meet a lot of new friends, and it's the horror host family. We're brothers and sisters. Like I said, it's a vampire tribute, which got me tearing up.
It's kind of like one of those things with your family. You know, you don't get together with your family till somebody dies. Well, Vampira died, so we had to make sure that she was brought back to life in some manner or another, so we paid a tribute to her. Gathered as many horror hosts together as we could. And I have to say that being there during the ceremony was one of the most beautiful things I've ever seen. People from all across the nation, monsters from all across the world, coming together to pay tribute to their mother.
In terms of the Vampira tribute, I think the overwhelming feeling I came away with from the entire event was one of community, a very strange community at that. But the fact that on a Sunday morning, you would have a group of over 80, I think, fully make-upped, fully dressed characters, all huddled into some little hallway in the middle of Indianapolis, preparing for this event, was peculiar to say the least. It really sort of exciting in the sense of possibilities that come from having a large group with a similar focus.
All of those horror hosts gathered in that room at the same time. The speakers, the things that they said, the emotions that they brought up. I talked to Robin Grizz from Midnight Mausoleum shortly after the event, and her eyes were still misty because of the emotion that she felt.
It was such a nice balance between people expressing themselves in a jolly group setting, but also hitting those marks over and over again about what Maila Nurmi represented, what Vampira represented, both as an image, as an artist, and as a woman throughout her years.
Maila once said something that has stuck with me. She said, "I like to shock because there's truth in it, and I'm after truth. A moment of truth, a split second of truth, is better than none at all." And I think that moment of truth is what brings us to horror, the large part of it anyway, what brought us all here today. And as Dr. Shocker was saying, I mean, seriously, we have werewolves, we have vamps, we have cadavers, we have... how many doctors do we have in the house today?
Is there a doctor in the house?
And just play one on TV.
And one thing is for certain, that we definitely are not in the horror hosting business to get rich. We're in it like Vampira or the Screams. And may we always remember that although Vampira is no longer with us in this life, she will always be but
to
scream away.
As a horror host, you're doing all of this stuff typically in your crypt, you know, at home, alone, and you're trying to broadcast your show to whoever will actually watch it. But it's very much a solo sort of thing, and to get everybody together in one room to pay tribute to first and foremost, the woman that started it all was incredible, and also to be all together instead of alone in our dungeons filming these shows.
Yeah,
some of the things that were said by Bone Jangler talking about the community.
I feel indebted to Maila Nurmi for coming out and setting the template, even if she reluctantly did so at first. She certainly came to embrace it, and even before she embraced it, she set the tone with her look and her style. She's a very fashionable woman. As Dr. Ghoulfinger pointed out, she was an artist. I'd like to think of all of us here, all of you, as my brothers and sisters, and I'd like to think of all of us as being artists. I appreciate everyone's art. I've seen most everyone's work here today, and I really think that all of you are artists and are to be applauded. I think you should applaud yourselves today. Beyond that, Maila Nurmi, I feel indebted to because, as Ms. Monster has said, she is the mother of us all. She is the foremother. She is the matriarch of all horror hosts. And for that, I will love her forever. And I feel that she is here today and is aware that this tribute is taking place for her. So I just want to say thank you, Maila.
Yeah, exactly.
It was a beautiful thing for a great lady.
Joe Senna was at the event doing the 100 Years of Monster Movies broadcast.
100 Years of Monster Movies had a marathon of live-hosted movies.
For, gosh, 50-some-odd hours straight, we streamed horror films from all different genres, old, great black-and-white stuff, up through some of the great Japanese Godzilla-style films, you know, big monsters breaking up cities, to a couple of newer independent films. Gave people a nice cross-section, nice sampling, nice little buffet of horror. And each film was introduced and hosted by a different horror host. No one's ever done anything like this before, and it was fantastic.
I got to host some movies on the 100 Years of Monster Movies, and that event is... while being totally separate, running at the same time concurrently, that event is a wonderful, wonderful experience for the hosting.
Thank you very much.
And it's allowed for a lot of us horror hosts to really show our craft. And, you know, people were exposed to horror hosts that they normally wouldn't be.
It is a great opportunity for hosts and also for the fans, because there is so much interaction while the movies are going on through the chat room.
And he's done that every Friday since then, and so different hosts host every week, and a lot of hosts get on the chat and interface with each other. So now there are kind of a lot of new horror host related memes, and there's a regular place for hosts to come and talk to each other and really kind of form a community and build something. And now that all began with the Vampire Tribute.
Other conventions had done a very good job of bringing horror hosts together. But it was more, and I'm not downplaying anything that they did, but it was really just more of a chance for these people to come together and kind of socialize and have some fun. We had a purpose in bringing these people together, building networks, growing in strength. This is very much a gestalt that, you know, the product of a horror host is much, much greater than the sum of the parts.
It really created a platform and a format to have people work together and to help leverage each other's shows and this art form, because it's clearly something that we all do because we love, not because we get rich doing it. Mm-hmm. And to have horror hosts, you know, united to come together in this one moment in time was pretty awesome.
It was great. That one photo was just incredible with everybody sitting there.
I still get the goosebumps just thinking about it.
Yeah. Indiana Whorehound. It's where all the fruits go to ripen.
Thank you.
The future of horror is in your hand, and you all know that. We, every one of us here today, need to continue this tradition started by Vampira nearly 7 decades ago. 7 decades is a long and honored history, and each and every one of you here now gets to carry the torch to the next group of horrors. I see children in the audience and I think, will one day one of these kids think, oh, you know what would be great? What if I just put on some makeup or a big frog head? And I'm not picking on you. By the way, you win. No matter what any of us have gone through, you win. You are Dr. Shocker's hero. And normally, Dr. Shocker is Dr. Shocker's hero.
It's very cool and amusing and funny and charming in your weird, dark sense. That there are still so many people out there that want to host bad horror movies, you know? Mm-hmm. So that's awesome. I think that's very cool that it continues to live like that.
Now people are starting to see there's more of us out there, and we're getting the respect, our due respect.
Get a camera, become a horror host. We need you. We only had 75, we need more. Take over the earth.
It was once going the way of the dodo bird, and now it's alive and flourishing. And I think that there's a lot of different styles out there for people to choose from. And, you know, it's like a trading card set. Collect one, collect them all, you know.
Recycling of old B material will happen forever, you know. It will always go on. And I think that people will come and companies will want to use horror hosts in new ways. I think, you know, they'll want to have horror hosts introing and outroing new films that they distribute, independent films.
Cool thing is, when you put on makeup, you could be doing this till you're 40, 50, 60 years old. Because you're just going to look the same because it's just makeup.
Yeah, he's really he's 73.
I am 75 years old. I fought in the Civil War, and I love horror monsters.
People just like to have the horror host. Have you ever heard anyone say, God, I wish this wasn't hosted? No. No. Everybody loves us!
Anybody that sees us and says, wow, that was great. It's worth being about. And in that way, as long as the film is there, we'll be immortalized as well.
I've long admired Vampira, and perhaps even more importantly, I also greatly admired her alter ego, Maila Nurmi. She was an artist, a creative force, an icon, and an independent woman who was fearless in her convictions and in her thinking. So while Vampira is surely the black cloth from which we are all cut, the memory of Maila Nurmi, the artist and the woman, should also embolden us to shed the shackles of mainstream society's constraints and strive for ever greater heights of creative expression.
Think about the impact she made being on one station for 14 years. About 2.5 minutes worth of video that has passed down, appearing in an Ed Wood movie yet.
Although that,
she has created the legacy upon which we all build our lives, our careers. And that legacy can be carried on by all of us. We each can create our own legacy built upon her, and she did it with talent, persistence, and professionalism. And a curiosity about the world around her. So let us embrace those qualities that she lived and gave us an example for, and let us carry forward so that the horror host will never die. Although some of us are pretty dead already.
Yeah.
I think this was wonderful to have a tribute to Vampira, because she really was the one that started it all for us. Had it not been for her, all of the other horror hosts probably wouldn't have had the creativity that she instilled in everyone.
Before you go, we have one last treat. We have Master Ron Fitzgerald, who is going to work a little magic And I think if we all believe that anything is possible, Master Ron Fitzgerald will make the impossible possible.
One of the, we had the tribute ceremony on Sunday. Everything kind of culminated into that. One of the events that we had held was a Vampira spookalike contest.
When we had Evelle LeChat, the winner, come out, I think she symbolized Vampira perfectly.
I just consider it a huge honor. I mean, to be able to represent her at this convention is probably the greatest honor that any horror hostess could ever have.
She did an amazing job. She really just has an incredible scream.
Ladies and gentlemen, Ron Fitzgerald!
In black. I know some of you do too. Oh hell yeah. Let me hear it. When we resurrect Vampira, when you hear her scream, I want you to scream with her.
That was awesome. She is here. Matter of fact, we'll get a shot of this right here, baby, where most of the people are already looking. I've got the Vampira belt buckle. Only one in the house. You want to walk up closer or you want to zoom in?